Hello students, welcome to discussion of numerical ability section of IBPS RRB Office Assistant Prelim Mock Test reference number MT204-2054. Now, the basic idea of having this discussion is, first we'll be looking at the strategy. So what are all areas that are present in this particular numerical ability section, and what is the order you should follow? And ideally, what is the time you need to spend on each of those areas? Also, we look at what is the minimum number of attempts you should look at, minimum number of attempts you should do as a within that stipulated time. All those things we'll be discussing as a part of this particular discussion. Also, when we are solving the questions, we'll try to see the best possible method to solve or attempt that question in the particular examination. Let us start with the strategy, students. There is no section-wise time limit given for IBPS RRB prelim mock test. Numerical ability and reasoning sections together, we have 45 minutes of time. So ideal time to be spent on numerical ability section is 25 minutes and reasoning is 20 minutes. Because quant is little time consuming, because we have individual questions or speed maths questions or data interpretation which demand a little more time. That's why we are saying spend that extra 5 minutes here, 25 minutes on quant, 20 minutes you can spend on reasoning ability. Now, if you analyze this particular mock test, MT204-2054, we have total 40 questions. Now, let us say there are 10 questions on simplifications, 5 questions on missing number series, 5 questions on quadratic comparisons, 5 individual quant questions, that is your arithmetic topics like equation, ratio, all topics together, there were 5 questions. Let us see what are the topics that were there, that were present in the paper. Then we have data interpretation, total 3 sets, 15 questions. Now, the order to be followed is more or less, is the same order if you follow, that's always helpful for you. When you begin the test, just see what are all the 40 questions from. You have total 40 questions, right? What areas were asked in the examination. Now, I can see 5 questions of simplification, maybe at the beginning of the paper, and 5 questions maybe towards the end of the paper. So, students, if you see, there are 10 questions on simplification. Simplifications are easy to score. Simplifications demand less time to solve. So, what you need to do is, first you need to finish off simplification questions. Then, you have to solve series questions, missing number series. Then, you have to solve quadratic comparisons. Follow the same order. First, solve simplifications, missing number series, quadratic comparisons, individual questions, and the last thing to attempt is your data interpretation. Now, 3 sets are there, total 15 questions. Out of those 3 sets, try to select 2 sets and solve them. Generally, when you are solving data interpretation, maybe your prelim exam or your main examination, one thing which you need to keep in mind is select the sets which are easy to attempt. Select the sets which you are comfortable with. Select the sets which you have practiced. Maybe you are good at table, select table. You are good at bar graph, select bar graph. You are good at line graph, select line graph. You are good at pie chart, select pie chart. But leave caselet in the examination. You know what is caselet, right? Caselet means some verbal information will be given. You have to capture this information in the form of a table or in the form of a Venn diagram. Then you need to solve the question. Generally, caselet needs one more step is involved. Like you have to put the data in the form of a structured format of it. You have to in the form of a table or in Venn diagram in a structured format. You have to write down. Then you have to solve the question. So, generally time consuming, and the risk is that if you make a small mistake and all questions might go wrong. So, caselet should be given last preference. That means you are done with all the areas, still time left over. Yes, then you can look at caselet. Otherwise, students, leave caselet in the examination. Now, as you can see here, in our this particular paper, we have one caselet. Caselet is easy here because prelim level caselets are generally easy when compared to main level. Main involves more data and maybe the 3-parameter, 2-parameter, what you call huge data will be given in main exam. But prelim exam will be given what you call limited data and a small paragraph. But still, we suggest time permits, then solve caselet. Otherwise, don't attempt caselet. Now, if you observe here, 10 questions of simplifications, ideal time to be spent is 5 minutes. And missing number series spent 3 minutes. Quadratic comparisons spent 3 minutes. Individual question, there are only 5 questions. I am saying spend 3 minutes of time. In 3 minutes, you can solve 3 to 4 easy questions out of the 5 given. and you can get out of that individual questions. Then you can see here, so 9 plus 5, 14 minutes are over. You can spend another 10 minutes, 24, 1 minute maybe at missing series or quadratic comparison, that 1 minute you can distribute. 10 minutes, you have to select two sets, 5 minutes per set, and you can solve. Or you do like this. If, let us say, you have done away in 3 minutes, you are good at DI, generally prelim DI, particularly curve will be easy. In 3 to 4 minutes you have done, another 3 minutes left over, 3 minutes in one set, 3 minutes in another set, 6-7 minutes are over, another 3 minutes left over, then maybe you try other areas, or you are done with your other areas, then you can try Caselet. Otherwise, strictly no. Right? Then minimum score, which you can look at, is minimum number of attempts. You can see here, out of these 10 questions, you can easily score 8 marks. You can get 8 questions correct. Missing number series, I am looking at minimum number of questions which you should get correct. You might have done 40 out of 40, 30 out of 40, 35 out of 40. But I am saying minimum, anything less than this, I am saying there is a serious concern. You need to revise your basics. You need to practice. You have to improve your speed. You have to improve your accuracy, right? So I am looking at minimum, what your student can look at, what the minimum number of attempts or minimum number of questions which you should get correct, right? Another quadratic equations, easily you can solve 3 questions. And individual questions, another easily you can solve another 3 questions. So another, I am saying 6 to 7 marks you can get correct in your DI. Now if you take this, another 6 to 8 let us say, how many will be 11, 14, 17, 23 to 25 questions. Anything less than 23 to 25, I am saying you need to seriously think about, you need to revise your concepts once again, improve your speed, practice more number of mock tests. Right students, let us start discussing our mock tests. Directions for question number 1 to 5. Study the bar graph given carefully and answer the following questions. Now, I am going in order 1 to 40, but in examination, when you see the first set is DI, don't start with DI. If you start with DI, I am saying you will be in trouble. Sometimes what happens is few DI sets will be time consuming, they demand more time. Instead of spending some 4 minutes, 5 minutes on that set, we will be sending somewhere around 15 minutes. Then you will not have time for the other areas. So while writing the mock test, you try to solve the order which I discussed sometime back. Start, solve simplification questions, all 10 questions, then series, quadratic, individual, then come to DI. Here, I will go in the order that is given in the paper, so that if I go here and back and forth, there is a chance that you will not understand. That is why I am doing that. But when you are writing the exam, you please follow the order which you have discussed, right? So bar graph, you can see here, marks scored by 5 students A, B, C, D, E in 3 different tests, each are given below. Now you can see here, 5 students I can see here, A, B, C, D, E. We have test 1, the plain bar is test 2, and this one is test 3. So we have got marks of test 1, test 2, test 3 of 5 students, right? Let us take a first question. What is the average mark obtained by all the students in test 1? So what is the definition of average? Average is nothing but sum of all quantities divided by total number of quantities, right? Sum of all quantities divided by total number of quantities. We need average of all the students in test 1. Now you can see a test 1 marks 70. Test 1, you have to take the first bar of each of the students. 70 plus 80, 150. 55, 55, 110. 150, 110, 260. And E is 40, 300. So my average is, test 1 total marks are 300 by 5 students. So average mark is 60. 60 is present in choice 3. Right? Question number 2 students. Which student got the highest average marks in all the 3 tests? Now, this is a very important point of average. This is based on a basic property. You don't find out average, don't find out average of all the 3 students, all 5 students, right? It is utterly time-based. What is the question? Whose student got highest average mark? Now you tell me one thing, there is a property of average. Average always lies between smallest value and highest value. You calculate average of 3 values, 10 values, 100 values. Average is always lies between smallest value and highest value. When it lies between smallest and highest, it is more than smallest and it is less than highest. For example, if I take 379, What is the average? 19 by 3. 19 by 3, 6 point something. What is my smallest value? 3. What is my highest value? 9. Average lies between smallest and highest. Lies between does not mean it's the middle value. It lies somewhere between smallest and highest. So when it lies somewhere between smallest and highest, it is definitely more than smallest and it is less than highest value. Right? So when I compare, this point is very important. When you compare with average, the lowest is always least and highest is always highest. Because we know that average lies between smallest and highest. When I compare with average, now if you see 379, when you compare with your average, 6 point something, which is least? 3 is least. Which is highest? 9 is highest. Always, when you compare with average, lowest value will be least and highest value will be highest. When you compare with average, lowest will be least, highest will be highest. Now don't waste your time and energy finding out average of each of the students. Now, which student has got highest average mark? The student who has got highest marks will get highest average marks. Because when you compare with average marks, which is highest? Highest mark is highest, lowest mark is always least. So don't find that average of these 5 students. The student who has got total marks, maximum total marks, will be more when compared with average. Now see here students, just compare A and B here. When I compare A and B, 70 and 80, don't add also, not required. B is 10 more, observation, just here, 45, test 2, 35. So in one first test, B is more, second test, A is more. First test, B is 10 more, second test, A is 10 more, net balance 0. Test 3 is a deciding factor, 60, 40. So obviously A is more, total of A, B is eliminated. Now when I compare C and D with A, clearly I can say C and D are less than A. By observation we can say the marks obtained by in 3 tests by C and D students are clearly less than A. Now we need to compare A and E. A and E are close here. So let us see here 70, 130 plus 45, the total is 175 A. And you can see here 120 plus 75, the total marks of E are 195. Who got more marks here? E got more marks here. So when you compare with average, highest marks will be highest. So 195 should be highest and E should be highest. Choice 4 is my answer. You got this point? When you compare with average, highest marks will be always highest and lowest should be always lowest. Now when I compare here, when I compare with A, B, C, D are clearly less than A. Eliminate them. You need to decide between A and E. Now don't find out average also, right? Who has got total marks more, that person will be more when you compare with average. Total marks of A are 175 in all 3 tests. Total marks of E are 195. So E is more. Question number 3, students. What is the ratio of marks obtained by students A and C together in test 2? Okay. A and C in test 2. A test 2 is 45. C test 2 is 30. 45 plus 30 is 75. To that of B and E in test 1. B test 1 is 80 and E test 1 is 40. 80 plus 40 is 120. 15 5s 75, 15 8s 120. Ratio should be 5 is to 8. Choice 5. Right? Question number 4. By how much percentage approximately is the average marks in test 2 more or less than test 3? So what is average marks in test 2? If you add here test 2, 45. 35, 80, 110, 175, 80, 255, test 2. Average is 255 total by 5 students, so 51. More or less than test 3. What is average marks of test 3 here? Test 3, if you add total marks, 60 plus 40, 100, 150, 185, 75, 260. 260 by 5, 52. So, average marks of test 2 is what percentage less than test 3? Percentage less. 51, 52, difference is 1. Opposite of less is, we have to write the opposite value. So, larger value, 52 into 100. So, approximately 50, if you take, it will be 2% approximately. Choice 2. Now, we are going little fast while discussing because see, the point is like you have already taken the test, you have analyzed the paper. Just we are discussing the strategy and solutions. So, we are going little fast. We want you to follow this speed. Otherwise, what happens is you will not pick up that speed in the examination. Right, students? Let us take up question number 5, students. In test 1, how many students got their average marks? How many students got more than their average marks of test 1? We have already calculated. What is average marks of test 1 in the first question we have done? 60. How many students in test 1 got more than 60? Less than 60, less than 60, less than 60, test 1, more than 60, more than 60. How many students are there? two students, right? Directions for question number 6 to 10. Solve the given quadratic equations and mark the correct options based on your answer as, we'll mark option 1 if x is greater than y, x is less than y option 2, x is greater than or equal to y option 3, x is less than or equal to 4 option 4, x equal to 5, or if you cannot establish any relationship, then option 5. These are your quadratic comparison questions. These are your quadratic comparison. So question number 6, students. First equation, x is equal to root 36. Second equation, 2y square minus y minus 6 is equal to 0. Let us spend some time on question number 6 so that you understand how to find out the roots very faster. That is using your, you should be good at your multiplication tables to find out the roots. Maybe you should be good at the factors of the numbers. Then you can easily find out the roots of the quadratic equation. Let us look at this. X is equal to root 36. The simplest, clearly x is equal to 6. Now don't say, sir, x is equal to plus or minus 6. When will it be plus or minus 6? X square, if it is given as 36, what will happen? X is equal to plus root 36 or minus root 36. So x is plus 6 or minus 6. Now what is root 36 value? 6 only. You observe here, what is root 36 value? 6 only here also. But we have a sign, minus sign before that. So it is minus 6. You got my point? X square is 36 means x may be plus root 36 or minus root 36. But x is equal to root 36 means x value is 6 only. Or I can also explain using your indices concept. X square is equal to 36 can be written as 6 square. When powers are equal, make the bases equal. But what is the power here? Even power. When even power is there, the bases will be equal, but it will have opposite signs, right? One will be plus 6, other will be minus 6. Otherwise here, x square is equal to 36 can also be written as minus 6 whole square. Right? So x is equal to minus 6. So when power is odd, then I can say bases are equal. When power is even, bases are equal, but will have opposite signs. Right, students? Now, let us find out roots of the second equation. Before that, let me give you the general form of the quadratic equation and let us discuss that. Now, ax square plus bx plus c is equal to 0. That's a general form of a quadratic equation. Ax square plus bx plus c is equal to 0. Where a is not equal to 0. Now, what we do is, see, there's a formula to find out quadratic equation. Second one is factorization method. Factorization method also, I'll try to tell you the easier approach to solve these particular questions, right? But you should be good at your multiplication tables. Now, we will multiply a and c, right? So, a into c, we'll get some value. And b also, we will have some value. If a into c is positive, if a into c is positive, write this b as sum of two numbers. For example, if a into c is negative, then write b, whatever value that we are getting for b, as difference of two numbers. That's all. Remember this point. If a and c, the product is positive, write b as this, whatever b value we having here, write it as sum of two numbers. If a into c is negative, write b as difference of two numbers. Now, let us see here, 2y square minus y minus 6 is equal to 0. Right? So, what is a into c? 2 into minus 6 minus 12. What is my b value? Minus 1. Now, write b as sum of, what you call a into c is negative, so write b as difference of two numbers. So, the difference, I have to write in such a way that I should get a difference of 1. Difference of 1 means you will get many numbers, but those two numbers product must be equal to 12. So, friends, I can say 4 and 3. What is difference of 4 and 3? It is 1. 4 into 3 is how much? 12. But see here, actually we should get a difference of how much? Minus 1. If you want to get a difference of minus 1, the larger number should be negative. What is minus 4 plus 3? Minus 1. What is minus 4 into 3? Minus 2. So multiply a into c. B value, write it as sum of two numbers if a into c is positive. If a into c is negative, write b as difference of two numbers. So 4 and 3 difference is 1. 4 into 3 is 12, but I should get minus 12 and we should get minus 1. So larger number, we should get minus 1 means larger number should be negative. So minus 4 plus 3 is minus 1, minus 4 into 3 is minus 12. But while writing the roots, you have to change the sign. So minus 4 will become plus 4 and you have to divide with the coefficient, right? What's the coefficient here? That is, you have to divide with a value by 2. 3 will become minus 3 by 2. You have to divide with coefficient of x square or y square, right? So roots are 2 comma minus 3 by 2. Now when you compare here, 6 is x value, 6 is more than 2, greater than 2, and 6 is greater than minus value, right? Minus 3 by 2. So clearly I can say x greater than y. X greater than y means choice 1 is minus. So you will multiply a into c and you will take b value. A into c is positive. You will write b as sum of two numbers. Condition is their product must be equal to a into c. If a into c is negative, we will write b as difference of two numbers such that those two numbers product must be equal to that a into c product, right? We'll take one more example, next question, then it will be clear. X cube is equal to 729. So x cube is equal to 729 is nothing but minus 9 cube. From this I can say x is equal to minus 9. What is y value here? Y square is equal to 36. This implies y is equal to plus 6 or minus 6. We have discussed this, right? Y square equal to 36 means y is equal to plus root 36 or minus root 36. If I take minus 9, minus 9 is less than 6 because it's a positive value. Minus 9 minus 6, minus 9 is less than minus 6. When it's a negative value, the smaller value will be greater. So clearly, x less than y. X less than y means it will be choice 2. Right. Question number 8 on your screen, students. 3x square minus 11x minus 20 is equal to 0. Let us take this equation. What is my a into c value? 3 into minus 20 is minus 60. So what is my b value? Minus 11. So as a into c is negative, we have to write b as difference of two numbers. Condition is that their product must be equal to 60. Now, difference of two numbers should be 11, product is 60. So if you look at your multiplication tables, I can say 15 and 4, 15 into 4 is 60, 15 and 4 difference is 11, but we should get minus 11, right? So larger number will be negative. Minus 15 plus 4, minus 11, minus 15 into 4 is minus 60. So when you're writing the roots here, you will change the sign. Minus 15 will be plus 15 divided by coefficient of x square, that is a value we have to divide by 3. So it will be 5, comma plus 4 will become minus 4 by 3. Now let us take this second equation. How much is a into c? 3 into 8, 24. How much is b value here? 10. Now a into c is positive means write b as sum of two numbers. Right? 10, I have to write it as sum of two numbers such that their product must be equal to a into c. So 10 can be written as 6 plus 4, 10. Their product must be 24. What is 6 into 4? 24. So 6, while writing the roots, you have to change the sign. So minus 6 by 3, comma, minus 4 by 3, right? Minus 6 by 3 is minus 2, comma, minus 4 by 3. Now, students, let us compare. If you take 5, 5 is a positive value. These two are negative roots here. So clearly, 5 is more than these two. Now, minus 4 by 3. Minus 4 by 3 is how much? 1.3 something, right? Minus 1.3, minus 2, this is greater. Because smaller value in negative will be greater. Minus 4 by 3, minus 4 by 3 are equal. So I can say x is either greater than y or equal to y. X is greater than or equal to y is present in choice 3. Question number 9. Let us write down the roots of this equation. How much is a into c? 2 into 3, 6. How much is b value? 7. So a into c is positive means this b, you have to write it as sum of two numbers. So I should get sum as 7 and product as 6. So 6 into 1, 6. 6 plus 1 is 7. While writing the roots, you have to change the sign. 6 will become minus 6. Divide with the coefficient. What is the coefficient a value here? Coefficient of x square, that is 2. Minus 6 by 2 is minus 3, comma minus 1 by 2. Now what about this? A into c, 2 into minus 6 is minus 12. How much is my b value? Minus 11. Now, see here, students, a into c is negative. That means we have to write b as difference of two numbers. We have to write in such a way that their sum, their product must be equal to 12. So we can write it as 12 and 1. 12 into 1 is 12 product. 12 and 1 difference is 11. But we should get minus 11 here. So larger number should be negative. Minus 12 into 1 is minus 12. Minus 12 plus 1 is minus 11. So while writing the roots, you have to change the sign. So it will be 12 by 2, that is 6. And this will be minus 1 by 2. Now, when we compare this, see here, x value, it is minus 3. If you compare with minus 3, minus 3, it is 6 here. So, it is negative value, it is less than positive value. Minus 3, minus 1 by 2. So, minus 3, minus 1 by 2 is minus 0.5. So, negative value, smaller will be greater. So, minus 3 is less than minus 1 by 2. Let us take this root. Minus 1 by 2. Minus 1 by 2 is less than 6 because it is positive value. Minus 1 by 2, minus 1 by 2 are equal. So, we can say x is either less than y or equal to y. X less than or equal to y is present in choice 4. Question number 10, students. 3x square minus 10x minus 8 is equal to 0. So, how much is a into c? 3 into minus 8 minus 24. And how much is my b value? Minus 10. Now, a into c is negative, right? B as difference of two numbers, right? Now, this can be written as 12 and 2. 12 and 2 difference is 10 and 12 into 2 product is 24. But actually, we should get minus 10 difference. So, larger number, let us make it into negative. Minus 12 plus 2 is minus 10. Minus 12 into 2 is minus 24, right? So, x roots are, you have to change the sign, 12 by 3, that is 4. Comma 2 will become minus 2 by, you have to divide with the coefficient of x square, that is a value. Let us look at this, a into c, 3 into minus 8 is minus 24 and b is equal to, we have got 10. Now, write, see here students, a into c, we are getting negative. That means write b as difference of two numbers and such a way that their product must be equal to 24. So, I am writing it as 12 and 2. 12 and 2 difference is 10. 12 into 2 product I am getting as 24. But we should get minus 24. And we should get plus 10. So, smaller number should be minus. Because we should get positive sum 10 here. 12 minus 2 is 10. 12 into minus 2 is 24. So, what is y value? Change the sign. Minus 12 by 3, comma, minus 2 will become plus 2 by 3. So, what will happen here? Minus 4, comma, 2 by 3. Now, when you compare here, x roots and y roots, we will not be able to get an establish a relationship here. If you see here minus 2 by 3, if you take this root, minus 2 by 3 is greater than minus 4, right? So, minus 2 by 3 is greater than minus 4. It is minus 0.66 minus 4, it is greater than this. But when you compare with 2 by 3, minus 2 by 3 is less than 2 by 3 because it is a positive value. In one case, it is less. In other case, it is greater. So, we cannot establish any relation. So, no relation can be established. So, option should be 5. Question number 6 to 10, students. What will come in place of question mark in the following questions? So, these are simplification questions, students. Just here, we need to find out this value. Let us take question mark as x value. 75% is 3 upon 4 into 11 by 16 into 576. Right? Now, how much is 16 into 4? 64. And if you see here, the last digit is 6. If I want to get last digit as 6, so 4 into what number is 6? Either 4 into 4, I'll get last digit as 6, or 4 into 9, I'll get last digit as 6. What is my total number? 576. So what is 4 into 60? It will be around 240, 250, right? If I do 9 times, 9 into 60 is how much? 540. I need 576, so it should be 9 times. Just check out. 69 is 540, 49 is 36, 576. So, this goes exactly 9 times. 9 into 3, 27 into 11. We know multiplication with 11, we'll put a 0 here. 7 plus 0, 7, 2 plus 7, 9. We'll start from right hand digit, we'll add rightmost digit to it. 0 plus 2 is 2. So, 297 present in choice 1. Right. Under root 2116. And under root 5625 is equal to x square. Now students, under root 5625, last two digits are 25 means it is square of some two digit number ending with 5. So clearly I can say this is a square of 75. How will you find out 75 square? What we do is 5 square will be always 25. We know this shortcut, right? 7 will increase by 1. It will become 8. 7 into 8 is 56. Let us say if I want to find out 65 square. Yes, here 5 square 25, increase 6 by 1, it will be 7, 6 into 7 is 42. If I want to find out 125 square, 5 square will be 25, increase whatever is left over by 1, 12 increase by 1 is 13, 12 into 13 is 156. So, we clearly know that it is 75. 2116, now this is a perfect square, we know this as how much? See, 2116 lies between 40 square, 45 square, how much? It lies between 45 square and 50 square. Because 45 square, we know that increase 4 by 1, 2025. 50 square is 2500. It lies between, the square root should lie between 45 and 50. And what is the last digit here? 6. So the square root should be either 46 or 47 or 48 or 49. What's the, I should get last digit as 6 means it should be 46 square. What is 46 square? We'll compare with 50 square, right? What's the base here? 2500. It is 4 less, so 2100 plus 4 less 4 square 16. It is 2116. We clearly know it is a square root is 46. 46 plus 71 is 121. It is x square. X is equal to root 121. Root 121 is nothing but my 11. Right, you understood this, right? 2116 lies between 45 square and 50 square. 45 square is 2025. 50 square is 2500. It lies between these two. That means it can be 46 or 47 or 48 or 49. Last digit 6 means, I am saying it has to be 46 square, right? So 46 square we know, compare with 50, it is 2100. 4 less than 50. 25 minus 4 is 2100 plus 4 square 16. 2116. It is a perfect square. We know it is a square root of 46. So 121 square is 11. This is very simple, students. Just here 0.4 goes 10 times in 4. Then 0,0 will get cancelled. 12 plus this 0.7 will come this side. It will become 12.7 choice 5. Now 1764 square root, right? Under root 1764. It lies between how much is 40 square? 1600. I'll say it lies between 40 square and 45 square. 45 square is 2025. We already seen. That means the square root lies between 40 to 45. Now between 40 to 45, what is my last digit here? 4. So last digit should be 4 means 40 to 41, 42, 43, 44. So last digit 2 means most likely it has to be 42 square. Check out 42 square. You have to compare with 50 square, 2500. 42 is 8 less than that. 25 minus 8 is 1700 plus 8 square. 1764. So clearly I know the square root of this number is 42. Now this is x percent, x by 100 into 105. 521 is 520s. So 21 goes 2 times, 2 into 20, x value will be 40. 40 present in first option. Now see here, students, x minus 2.5 is equal to, what I do is, I'll do like this, just here. This will be 3 by 4, 3 into 112 by 4 into 8. Clear all of you? Because this 0.75, I'm writing it as 3 by 4. We know it is 3 by 4. So 3 by 4, 8 into 4 is how much? 32. 16 sevens, 112, 16 twos, 32. 21 by 2 is 10.5. So add this 2.5, 10.5 plus 2.5 should be 13. Question number 16 to 20, choose the correct alternative from the given choices. These are individual quant questions. The ratio of salaries of Kiran and Mohan is 5:7. Each of them spent 25% of his salary on rent. Find the amount spent by Mohan if the remaining total amount with them is 94,500. Let us take Kiran's salary as 5K, Mohan's salary as 7K. So what is the total salary? 5k plus 7k, 12k, right? 5k plus 7k, total salary is 12k. Each of them is spending 25% on rent. That means Kiran is spending 25% on rent, Mohan is spending 25% on rent. So both of them together spend 25%. So out of the total salary, how much are their savings? 75%. So 75% is nothing but 3/4 of the salary, 3 by 4 of 12k. Is equal to savings are combined savings 94,500. 4 goes 3 times, right? So 9k is 94,500. 9 goes how many times? 910 if I put, 95 is 45. 10,500. This is my k value. Now, what is the question? Amount spent by Mohan. What is Mohan's salary now? Mohan's salary is 47k. So 7 into 10,500. So how much he is spending, amount spent by Mohan? 25% of the salary. 25% means 1 by 4 of, this is how much? 735. 105 into 7 is 735 followed by 2 zeros. Right? So let us keep these 2 zeros aside. Just here, don't simplify this, time waste. Now, what is it? I'm dividing 735 by 4. You have to check the divisibility rule, last two digits. Let us keep these two zeros aside, right? So, it is 100. If you're multiplying by 25, let it is 100 by 4. The same concept here. 4 8s are 32. What is the remainder? 3. Remainder 3 means my last two digits should be how much? 75. When you're dividing by 4, generally what happens? Exactly divisible means last two digits are 0, 0. Remainder of 1 means last two digits are 25. Remainder of 2 means last two digits should be 50. Remainder of 3 means last two digits should be 75. Here in the given options, which option is having last two digits as 75? Third option, answer choice 3. Don't even simplify, don't even what you call the divide and multiply. Directly we can answer this question. There's only one option with last two digits as 75. Now, Manish invests rupees 15,000 on compound interest for 2 years and earns an interest of 2,496 for 2 years. Find the rate of interest per annum. Now, what is net rate of interest for 2 years? We can use the shortcut formula for compound interest. For 2 years, my net rate of interest can be find out. We can find out net rate of interest using our successive percentage formula x plus y plus xy by 100%. Right? We can find out net rate of interest using this formula x plus y plus xy by 100%. Right? Now, 15,000 for 2 years, I am getting an interest of 2,496. 2,496 upon 15,000. Into 100. Now, see it, simple calculation. How much is my 10%? 1500 in the base. What is my 20%? 3000. Right, if this interest rate is 20% for 2 years, net rate of interest I'm calculating, it should be 3000. But how much I'm having? 2496. So obviously, it is clearly less than 20%. Now, just look at the options. If per annum my interest rate is 10% for 2 years, what is my net rate of interest? We know 10 is easy, right? We have done in our classes also. 10 plus 10 plus 10 into 10 by 100. For 2 years, net rate of interest should be 21%. For 2 years, my net rate of interest we are getting is how much here? Less than 20%. Don't even calculate how much is that. If you calculate, you'll get 16 point something. I'm saying it is less than 20. For 10%, if I'm getting 21, I should get less than 20. Means my per annum interest rate should be less than 10. Less than 10, how many options are there? There is only one option. Remaining all options are more than 10%. So straight away, I can eliminate that. 18th question. A boat travels 24 kilometers in upstream in 4 hours, 48 kilometers in downstream in 3 hours. Find the speed of the stream. Right? So speed of the boat, let us take it as B. Speed of the stream, let us take it as W. So what is upstream speed? Upstream speed is equal to B minus W. Speed is equal to distance by time, right? We know that speed is distance by time. So 24 kilometers in 4 hours. So B minus W is 6. So what is my downstream speed? Downstream speed is equal to B plus W, right? B plus W, distance by 48, by time is 3 hours. So 48 by 3. So I'll get 16. We need stream value, W value. Subtract this. So BB will get cancelled. Minus 2W is equal to minus 10. So W value will be 5. 5 is present in choice 3. Two inlet pipes X and Y can fill a tank in 32 minutes and 80 minutes. There are two filling pipes. The first pipe can fill in 32 minutes. The second pipe can fill in 80 minutes. Find the time taken by X and Y together to fill 1 by 8th of the tank. Now, when two filling pipes are there, we can find out time taken by pipes X and Y is given by product by sum. A can complete in certain number of days, B can complete in certain number of days, A and B together can complete the work in product by sum. So, I can say 32 into 80 by 32 plus 8, sorry, how much? 32, right? So, 32 into 80 by 32 plus 80 is 112. But he's not asking you time taken to fill the entire tank. He's asking you time taken to fill 1/8 of the tank. So, 1 by 8th of 32 into 80 by 112. Now, see here, 8 goes 10 times, 16 to 16 sevens. So, obviously, it is 20 by 7. 7 twos are 14, 6 is remaining. 2 6 by 7 minutes, it is present in choice 4. This is a shortcut, product by sum. Question number 20. The area of circle C1 is 38.5 cm square and that of C2 is 346.5 cm square. Find the difference in diameter of D1 and D2. We know that diameter is equal to 2 times the radius. right? Diameter is 2 times the radius. If I want radius, radius is nothing but d by 2. Let us take first circle radius as r1, the second circle what you call radius as r2. So what will be my diameter? Area formula is pi r1 square is 38.5. Here second circle pi r2 square is 346.5. Now in place of r1, r is nothing but half of diameter, right? I can substitute d1 by 2. So d pi into pi is nothing but how much? 22 by 7 into r1 is nothing but d1 by 2. R1 square means d1 square by 4 is equal to 38.5. Similarly, 22 by 7 into R2 is nothing but D2 by 2. So, R2 square means D2 square by 4 is 346.5. Now, if you can observe here, these are multiples of 11. Alternate digit sum, you take 8 minus 8 is 0. So, if the difference is sum of alternate digits, starting from unit digit, the difference is 0 or a multiple of 11, that is divisible by 11. Just observe this, 5 plus 4, 9, 6 plus 3, 9. So both are multiples of 11. So 11 2 is 22, 11 3 is 33, 11 1 is 11 5. Right? 2 goes 2 times here. So d2 square is equal to 31.5 into 2 is 63 into 7. Right? Similarly, observe this, 11 2 is, 11 3 is 33, 11 5 is 55, 3.5, 2 goes 2 times. D1 square is equal to 3.5 into 2 is 7 into 7. So what is my D1? 7. What is my D2? Simple. D2 is square root of this, right? 63 is can be written as 7 into 9 into 7. 7 and 7 I'll get 1, 7. 9 square root is 3. So 7 into 3 D2 is 21. Difference in diameter will be 14 centimeter present in choice 5. Directions for question number 21 to 25. What should come in place of question mark in the following number series? Number series questions are simple to solve. The solution is given in your mock test itself. You have taken the mock test. We have clearly given the solution. You can look at the solution there. I am not discussing number series questions here. Question numbers 26 to 30. Now, this is a tabular data. The table shows details of number of persons who attended a business seminar from three countries, 17, 18 and 19. So, country P, Q and R, 17, 18, 19, you have got how many number of people who have attended the seminar. Let us start with question number 26. What is the ratio of number of persons who attended the seminar from P and Q in 2017? P and Q in 2017 is 280 is to Q and R in 2019. Q and R in 2019, 28 and 24 is 52. So, 520. So, 4 7s, 4 13. 7 is to 13 is present in choice 5. Question number 27. What is the difference in number of persons who attended the seminar from P in 17 and 18? 17 and 18 together, how many attended from P? 120 plus 200, 320. And number of persons who attended the seminar from Q and R in 17. Q and R in 17 is 270. 16 plus 11 is 27, so 160 plus 110 is 270. So difference between these two is 50, 50 present in fifth option. Question number 28, in 2017 and 2019, the total number of persons who attended the seminar from P is what percentage of total number of persons who attended the seminar in these 2 years only? So 2017 plus 2019, in these 2 years, number of people who attended from P, 120, 160, 280. Number of persons in these 2 years who attended from R, 110 plus 240, 350. P is what percentage of R? P by R into 100. So I can write 28 by 35 into 100. Anyway, 0 will get cancelled. 7 4s are 28, 7 5s are 35. 4 by 5 is 80%. So 28 upon 35, 7 4s, 7 5s, 4 upon 5 is 80%. Question number 29, average number of persons who attended the seminar from P in all the 3 years. So, average is sum of all quantities by total number of quantities. Add this, 120 plus 200, 320 plus 160, it is 480. So, 3 years are there, 480 by 3, I can say 160 is the average. 160 is present in choice 1. Or, you observe here, 120, 200, 160. What is my lowest value? 120. What is my highest value? 200. My average should lie between 120 and 200. From the given options, I can straight away say these two are straight away eliminated, right? So my average should lie between 120 and 160. So between these two, I have 160. Let us assume average is 160. If average is 160, 200 is how much more? 40 more. Average is 160, 120 is how much less? 40 less. So this 40, if I distribute here, this is 640 left, this 40 will be here. So this will become 160. If I give 40 here, this will become 160. This no change here, 160. 160, 160, 160, average is 160. Orally by observation also, we can answer this question. Question number 30, students. By what percentage is total number of persons who attended the seminar from Q in 17 and 18? 17 and 18 from Q. 160 plus 140, 300. What percentage more or less than total number of persons who attended the seminar from R in 17 and 18? 110 plus 290, it is 400. So Q is less, so we need to find out percentage less. Percentage less, anyway, zeros will get cancelled. I'm ignoring the 3 and 4. Difference is 1. Opposite of less is larger value, 4 into 100. 1 upon 4 is, we know that 25%, and it has to be 25% less. 25% less is my choice too. Question number 31 to 35, students. What will come in place of question mark in the following questions? So these are simplification questions, students. 2 square is 4, 3 square is 9. 4 into 9 is 36. Is x into 72 divided by root 256? Root 256 is 16 because we know 16 square is 256. 36 goes 2 times, 2 goes 8 times. So x value should be equal to 8, present in choice 2. Root under root 22 plus 27 under root 22 plus 27 is 49 into 25 25 root is 5 49 root is 7 7 into 5 is 35 35 is present in choice 4. Question number 33. 8 1 by 7 minus 5 1 by 7 1 by 7 1 by 7 will get cancelled. 8 minus 5 is 3 is 75 by x. 3 goes 25 times. We can say x is equal to 25. 25 is present in choice 1. Question number 34, students. See here. According to board maths rule, you have to simplify the expression inside brackets first. So 8 goes 2 times here. So 6 2s are 12. So 25 by 2 into 72 is x into 45. 2 goes 36 times. So x is equal to 25 into 36 by 45. 9 5s, 9 4s. 5 goes 5 times in 25. 5 into 4 is 20. Choice 2 is my answer. Now this is interesting. 70% of 6.5 into 8 plus x is equal to 40. How much is 6.5 into 8? 8 6 are 48. 0.5 into 8 is 4. So 52. 70% can be taken as 0.7. So what is 7 into 52? Forget 0.7. We can keep few point later. 7 50 is 350. 7 2 is 14. It is 364. So 0.7 into 52 means, just put a point here, it will be 36.4. So 40 minus 36.4, I should get 6 here. 4 plus how much is 0? 6 here. So last digit should be 6 after point. 6 means among the given options, I can say 3.6 is my answer. Question number 36 to 40. Right. This is what I was talking about. This is your caselet, students. Right. Caselet, you have to first put this, whatever data is given, in the form of a table. Sometimes if more than two parameters are given, you have to put it in the form of a Venn diagram, then you have to solve. But point is, caselet should be left out. If you solve all questions, still time left over in the exam, then only you have to attempt these caselet questions. Now see here, students, a company has 2,400 employees total in three departments, P, Q and R, which includes men and women. Now see here, I have three departments, P, Q, R. This department, I have men employees and we have women employees and we have total also, right? A simple table, something, it will look something like this, right? Right. 37.5%. 37.5% is nothing but 3 by 8, students, for your information I'm telling you. Of the total employees in PR, women. Number of male employees in Q are 333 1 by 3 percentage. 333 1 by 3 percentage is nothing but 10 by 3. 999 plus 1000 by 300, nothing but 10 by 3 of women employees of P. Number of women employees of R is 100 more than that of Q. Number of women employees in P is 150. Very good. We know women employees in P is 150. And total number of employees in R is 1200. Total R is 1200, right? And number of women employees in P is 150. Now you see here, in the first point, if you observe, women employees are 37.5% of total number of employees in P are P. 37.5 means it is 3 by 8. Now, 3 by 8 is 150. That means women are 150. 3 parts, 150. 1 part, how much? So it will be 150 by 3. Each part is 50. My total, in ratio, what will you write? Total, right? So 8 parts will be total. 8 into 50, 400. This is 400. Men should be 250. You got the point here. You don't read all these 37.5% are women employees. That is nothing but 150, 100% how much. No need to do all this. It's time waste. 37.5% is 3 by 8. What is that 3 by 8? That is number of women employees. So what will you write? Women are 3 parts. In the denominator, in the ratio, it will be always total parts. So we know that 3 parts, women, we know it is 150. So 3 parts, 150 means 1 part is 50. Total is 8 parts, 8 into 50, 400. So 400, 150 are women, men are 250. Now number of male employees in Q is 333, 1 by, that is 10 by 3 of women employees of P. So 10 by 3, into women employees of P. Women employees of P is 150. 3 goes 50 times. So it is 500. Sorry. This is P, right? 250. This is 1 second. Let me erase this. This is 150 here and total. I have written in Q by mistake P values. Sorry, student. This is 150 and this is 400. Right? Now I am writing Q value. Q value is how much? 10 into 5, 500. Number of male employees in Q are 500. Then, number of women employees in R is, we know that this is 400, this is 1200, 1600. Total should be 2400. So, this should be 800. This is 500. So, women employees should be 300. Now, number of women employees in R, 100 more than Q. This is 300. This should be 400. 1200 minus 400, male employees should be 800. Right? So, the same data, I have put it in a form of table. See here, P 250, 150, 400, 250, 150, 400, Q 500, 300, total 800, R 800, 400, total 1200. Once you get this table, questions are easy to solve. Total number of women employees in the company. Total number of women employees 700 plus 150, it is 850 present in first option. Question number 37. Ratio between female employees of P and male employees of R together. Female of P, male of R, 950 is 2. Male employees of Q and female employees of R. Male of Q is 500, female of 400, 900. Male of Q, female of R. So what is the ratio, students? 519s, 518s. 19 is to 18 present in choice 3. Question number 38. Find the percentage of female employees in the company. We got total female employees as 850, right? So, 850 upon total employees are 2400 into 100. Now, students, no need to calculate. What is 800 upon 2400? It is 1 by 3. 1 by 3, we know that it is nothing but 33, 1 by 3%. But we don't have 800. We have how many female employees? 850. So, my answer should be more than 33, 1 by 3%. More than 33, 1 by 3% is only one option. 35, 5 by 12, choice 5. No need to find out the percentage. Don't waste your time. Question number 39. Find the difference between male employees and female employees. Now, here you can see it is 850. So, male employees are how many? 1550. Because total is 2400. If you add this, you will get 1550. So, difference is how much? 700. 700 is present in choice 4. Question number 40. Number of female employees in the company is how much percent more or less than male employees in the company? Female employees are 850. Male employees are how many? 1550. We can ignore this 0 here. So, female employees are 85. Male employees are 155, right? So it is what per, it is clearly less. Percentage less is different 70. By opposite of less is larger value, 155 into 100. Now 14 upon 31. Now see here, students, what is 50% of 31? 50% is 15.5. Right? We need 14. That means I got how much extra? 1.5 extra. Now, how much is 1%? 1% is 0.3. I have to put a point after 2 digits. How much is 0.5%? 1.5. So I have to remove around 5%. My answer should be around 45%. Around 45%, which option is there? Second option. That should be your answer. Right, students? Thank you so much. The basic idea is we are trying to tell you how you should follow the order. The speed you should match, right? The speed at which we are solving, if you try to, you have to match that speed, then only you will be able to improve your speed. So always when you write this free mock test, we suggest you go through the complete analysis. That means, again, see how many questions are correct, how many questions are wrong. Whatever questions you have made mistake, again, try to analyze why that mistake was done. Because I am answering that question means I know the answer for that question. But you have made a mistake. Analyze that mistake. Identify that mistake. You will not repeat that in the future. Then, the questions which you have not attempted, let us say 40 plus 40, 80 questions. You have not attempted some 30 questions, let us say. Again, solve those 30 questions. Once you analyze the paper, then you attend this discussion session. Then definitely it will help you. Otherwise, you will feel that it is little fast. I am trying to push you because I want you to think on those lines. If you think faster, then only your speed will improve. Right? So, we will have some more free mocks and discussions. Hope you try to analyze the paper, solve it once again, analyze your mistakes and attend this discussion, watch this discussion session. Then it will always help you. Thank you so much, students.